From New York, this is Democracy Now!
Just over a week ago, many of the pundits declared that this candidacy was dead. Now we're very much alive.
Super Tuesday 2. Former Vice President Joe Biden scores decisive primary victories Tuesday, including in the key state of Michigan, with Bernie Sanders slightly ahead, though too close to call, in Washington and North Dakota. We'll get response from The Intercept's Naomi Klein and Alicia Garza with Black Futures Lab, co-founder of the Black Lives Matter Global Network. Then, as the coronavirus pandemic grows, nurses on the front lines are holding a national day of action to protest lack of basic protections for nurses and their patients.
When something doubles every day, it gets to a very large number very quickly. So if there are 1,000 people infected today, in 7 or 8 weeks, there could be 64,000 people infected in the state of Washington if we don't somehow slow down this epidemic.
We'll speak with the president of National Nurses United, Gene Ross. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. New York Governor Andrew Cuomo has deployed the National Guard to New Rochelle, a suburb of New York City in Westchester County, ordering a one-mile containment zone around a synagogue whose congregation is at the center of the nation's single largest coronavirus outbreak. National Guard members were ordered to disinfect schools, to set up a coronavirus testing facility, and to deliver food to people in quarantine, including thousands of students forced to remain at home. This is Governor Cuomo speaking Tuesday.
It is a dramatic action, but it is the largest cluster in the country. And this is literally a matter of life and death. That's not an overly rhetorical statement.
In Washington state, Governor Jay Inslee ordered a ban on community gatherings of more than 250 people as a nursing home in King County reported two more deaths Tuesday, raising Washington's death toll to 25. This comes as the New York Times reports the coronavirus spread undetected in Washington for weeks after state and federal officials rejected a Seattle infectious disease expert's pleas to repurpose a flu study to monitor for coronavirus. By the time the researcher unilaterally decided to begin testing, two people had died and scores had become infected. In Massachusetts, Governor Charlie Baker has declared a state of emergency as the number of confirmed corona cases hit 92. 70 of the cases are linked to a single conference held by the biotech firm Biogen in Boston last month. In Ohio, the campaigns of both Bernie Sanders and Joe Biden abandoned plans for competing rallies Tuesday night in Cleveland after Governor Mike DeWine ordered all major indoor events canceled. In contrast, President Trump announced his next rally for March 19th in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, even though his own coronavirus task force encouraged people not to go to large public gatherings. Across the United States, about 60 colleges and universities have canceled in-person classes and asked students to attend online. A number of public schools closed, affecting tens of thousands of students. The NCAA is preparing to hold some March Madness college basketball games in front of empty sports arenas. Google told all of its 120,000 full-time employees in North America to work from home. Coachella has been delayed. Meanwhile, the federal government is developing a plan to have hundreds of thousands of employees telecommute. At the White House, Vice President Mike Pence said Tuesday, private insurance companies will join Medicare and Medicaid in waiving co-payments for coronavirus testing. Coronavirus Task Force member Dr. Anthony Fauci warned people to take steps to slow the spread of the disease, like social distancing and avoiding handshakes, washing hands, and staying home when feeling ill.
We would like the country to realize that as a nation, we can't be doing the kinds of things we were doing a few months ago, that it doesn't matter if you're in a state that has no cases or one case. You have to start taking seriously what you can do now, that if and when the infections will come, and they will come, sorry to say, sad to say, they will.
The number of U.S. coronavirus cases has topped 1,000, with at least 31 deaths. Worldwide, there are nearly 121,000 confirmed cases, the majority of them in China, where over 3,100 people have died. In Iran, there have been 291 deaths and about 8,000 confirmed cases. Iran's chief justice on Monday ordered the temporary release of 70,000 prisoners to slow the spread of the virus. The United Nations Special Rapporteur on Human Rights in Iran responded by calling on authorities to release political prisoners still being held, including thousands arrested during a bloody crackdown on anti-government protests last November. In Europe, cases of COVID-19 have now been confirmed in every country in the European Union. Hardest hit is Italy, where authorities have placed travel restrictions on the entire population of 60 million people. In Britain, junior health minister Nadine Dorries was diagnosed Tuesday with coronavirus. Her illness has sparked fears in the British Parliament, which she recently visited, and at 10 Downing Street, the Prime Minister's residence, where she attended a reception last week. Other high-level European officials have also tested positive for coronavirus, including the president of the European Parliament, the leader of an Italian political party, the culture minister of France, and the secretary general of the Vox Party in Spain. Back in the United States, the head of the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention told lawmakers Tuesday that President Trump's expanded wall on the U.S.-Mexico border would do nothing to mitigate the spread of COVID-19, as President Trump has claimed. CDC Director Robert Redfield also agreed with a Democratic lawmaker that it was wrong for Republicans to refer to COVID-19 as the Chinese coronavirus or Wuhan virus. This week, China's foreign ministry condemned the rhetoric as a despicable campaign to stigmatize China. President Trump and lawmakers opened talks Tuesday on a massive emergency relief package aimed at blunting the impact of coronavirus on the U.S. economy. Trump floated the idea of a payroll tax cut that would eliminate nearly $700 billion in revenue from Social Security by the end of the year. The proposed payroll tax cut was attacked by economists who noted it would deliver most help to households least in need. And the advocacy group Social Security Works tweeted, quote, "This is a Trojan horse attack on our Social Security system, which will do nothing to meaningfully address the COVID-19 crisis," unquote. Meanwhile, The Washington Post reports the White House is strongly considering pushing federal assistance for oil and natural gas producers hard hit by the coronavirus outbreak and a price war between Russia and Saudi Arabia. Former Vice President Joe Biden scored decisive primary victories Tuesday night in Michigan, Missouri, Mississippi, and Idaho. Meanwhile, Bernie Sanders is leading in Washington State and North Dakota, where votes are still being counted. He's neck and neck with Biden. While Biden is less than halfway to the delegates he would need to secure the Democratic nomination, he declared victory during a speech in Philadelphia.
And I want to thank Bernie Sanders and his supporters for their tireless energy and their passion. We share a common goal, and together, we'll defeat Donald Trump. We'll defeat him together.
Joe Biden was speaking in Philadelphia. He had canceled his rally in Ohio, as did Senator Bernie Sanders, who returned to his home in Vermont Tuesday night and did not make a public statement. Earlier Tuesday, Sanders stressed the differences between his campaign and Biden's during a campaign stop in Detroit.
Here in Michigan, where trade agreements have been so devastating in the loss of over 100,000 good-paying jobs, Joe Biden voted for NAFTA. He voted for PNTR with China. I helped lead the opposition to those disasters.
That's right. Yeah!
Exit polls in every state voting Tuesday showed strong support for Bernie Sanders' Medicare for All program, even in Mississippi, where it has the backing of nearly two-thirds of Democratic voters. But speaking on MSNBC on Monday, Joe Biden indicated if elected president, he would veto Medicare for All legislation should Congress pass it and send it to his desk.
I would veto anything that delays providing the security and the certainty of health care being available now.
Less than 2 weeks after losing his front-runner status, Sanders faces a decision about whether to continue his increasingly uphill fight for the Democratic Party's 2020 presidential nomination. South Carolina Congressmember Jim Clyburn, the number three House Democrat who earlier helped lead Biden to victory in South Carolina, told NPR Sanders should shut his primary down.
I think we will be at a point where Joe Biden will be the prohibitive nominee of the party. And I think the DNC, the Democratic National Committee, should then step in, make an assessment, and determine whether or not they ought to have any more debates.
On the campaign trail, former Vice President Biden Tuesday told a union auto worker in Detroit he was full of bleep and threatened to fight him. Biden made the threat during a photo op at Detroit's first new auto assembly plant to be built in decades. The exchange began when the auto worker accused Biden of actively trying to end the Second Amendment. After cursing at the man, Biden repeatedly told a female aide to shush before touting his ownership of shotguns and saying he supports the Second Amendment. Biden threatened to slap the man in the face and threatened to take him outside for a fight. During the exchange, Biden also mistakenly referred to the AR-15 semi-automatic assault rifle as an AR-14. There were reports of irregularities at many polling sites during Tuesday's primaries in Missouri. Some would-be voters in St. Louis County left long lines at dozens of precincts without casting a ballot after the county's electronic poll books failed. In Kansas City, Mayor Quinton Lucas was turned away from the polls Tuesday morning and told he wasn't in the system, even though he's voted in the same precinct since 2009. Mayor Lucas had just posted a video to social media stressing the importance of voting. In Michigan, disabled voters reported problems voting in Detroit and Dearborn. And college students in Ann Arbor and East Lansing reported long lines with wait times of up to 2 hours. In a statement, Senator Bernie Sanders called the voting problems an outrage, writing, quote, "At a time when Democrats correctly attack Republicans for voter suppression, it's disappointing to see people standing in long lines for hours today waiting to vote in Michigan and around the country. People should not have to miss a day of work to exercise their right to vote," he said. Bernie Sanders said in a statement, "We'll have the latest on the Democratic presidential race after headlines with journalist and activist Naomi Klein and Alicia Garza, co-founder of the Black Lives Matter Global Network." In Saudi Arabia, reports have emerged of a new crackdown on senior royal members and top officials as Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman appears to be renewing efforts to consolidate power in the kingdom. At least four prominent members of the royal family have reportedly been detained. In Russia, President Vladimir Putin has endorsed a plan that would allow him to remain in power until 2036. The legislation was approved by the lower house of the Russian parliament, the Duma, on Tuesday, but must be approved by Russia's constitutional court in a public referendum to be held in April. Putin had already proposed constitutional changes that would allow him to remain in power beyond 2024. In Venezuela, security forces Tuesday tear gassed protesters led by Venezuelan opposition leader Juan Guaido to prevent them from marching on the National Assembly, which is currently under the control of pro-government lawmakers. This is the first protest triggered by Guaido after he led an international tour hoping to win support for the ouster of Venezuelan President Nicolas Maduro. Guaido is reportedly trying to revive these efforts as the country's economic crisis continues to worsen. Meanwhile, United Nations High Commissioner for Human Rights Michelle Bachelet warned U.S.-imposed sanctions on Venezuela's airline and oil industries are decimating social spending and leading to shortages of food and medicine in Venezuela. Bachelet was speaking at the U.N. Human Rights Council in Geneva Tuesday.
Respecto a los derechos económicos y sociales,
on economic and social rights, I am concerned by the imposition of new economic sanctions, particularly those that affect airlines and the sanctions on the oil industry, and changing the use of government expenditures that are meant to be used for social ends. Also, problems with importing food, medication, and humanitarian aid.
And in Minnesota, thousands of union teachers and other school staff in the city of St. Paul began a strike Tuesday after contract talks with the city's school district broke down. The St. Paul Federation of Educators, which represents some 3,600 educators and school staff, are demanding funding for mental health services for students, as well as more multilingual interpreters and special education funding. And a slight correction, South Carolina Congress member Clyburn said it was the DNC should shut the primary down at this point. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman.
And I'm Juan Gonzalez. Welcome to all of our listeners and viewers across the country and around the world. Former Vice President Joe Biden scored decisive primary victories Tuesday night in the key state of Michigan, along with Missouri, Mississippi and Idaho. Sanders holds leads in North Dakota and Washington state, but votes are still being counted and the races are still too close to call. While Biden is less than halfway to the delegates he would need to secure the Democratic nomination, he declared victory during a speech in Philadelphia.
Just over a week ago, many of the pundits declared that this candidacy was dead. Now we're very much alive. Although there's a way to go, it looks like we're going to have another good night. And I want to thank Bernie Sanders and his supporters for their tireless energy and their passion. We share a common goal, and together, we'll defeat Donald Trump. We'll defeat him together.
As Biden appealed to the supporters of his rival, Bernie Sanders, returned to his home in Vermont Tuesday night and did not make a public statement. But one of his most prominent supporters, Representative Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, expressed her disappointment on Instagram.
You know, there's no sugarcoating it. Tonight's a tough night. Tonight's a tough night for the movement overall.
Less than 2 weeks after losing his frontrunner status, Sanders faces a decision about whether to continue his increasingly uphill fight for the Democratic Party's 2020 presidential nomination. South Carolina Congressmember Jim Clyburn, the number three House Democrat, who earlier helped lead Biden to victory in South Carolina with his impassioned endorsement of him, told NPR if Sanders did not win more delegates, then it's time to, quote, shut this primary down, apparently suggesting the Democratic National Committee should cancel future debates like the one scheduled this Sunday.
I think we will be at a point where Joe Biden will be the prohibitive nominee of the party. And I think the DNC, the Democratic National Committee, should then step in, make an assessment, and determine whether or not they ought to have any more debates.
As the primary results came, longtime Democratic Party strategist James Carville claimed on MSNBC that Biden's success means it's now time to end the Democratic primaries.
This is all about November. These voters want to shut this thing down. I mean, you can just look all across the spectrum of the Democratic Party, and people are saying, we made our decision. This is who we're going with. Let's shut this puppy down, and let's move on and worry about November. This thing is decided. There's no reason to keep it going, but not even a day longer.
All of this comes as Biden and Sanders called off their planned campaign rallies in Cleveland on Tuesday night because of concerns over the coronavirus, which continues to spread. In contrast, President Trump announced his plans last night to launch a Catholics for Trump coalition at a rally on March 19th in Milwaukee, where the Democratic National Convention is set to take place in July, if in fact it does. For more, we're joined by Naomi Klein, senior correspondent at The Intercept and the inaugural Gloria Steinem Chair of Media, Culture and Feminist Studies at Rutgers University, which looks like it's going online. Her new book is titled On Fire, The Burning Case for a Green New Deal. Alicia Garza is also with us, Strategy and Partnerships Director for the National Domestic Workers Alliance, principal at the Black Futures Lab, co-founder of the Black Black Lives Matter Global Network. She's joining us from Berkeley, California. We welcome you both to Democracy Now! Naomi, let's begin with you. And we're spending the hour, and in a little while, we'll be joined by the president of the National Nurses United Union. And we're going to talk about both the primaries, coronavirus, what the pandemic means. But this latest quotes that we're hearing right now, after Super Tuesday 2 finished last night, of, as Carville put it, shutting this puppy down, and Clyburn, the South Carolina congressman, calling on the DNC to end the primaries with Biden's lead at this point. Your thoughts?
Well, I think that it is part of a reckless pattern of trying to keep Joe Biden away from voters. And, you know, ever since there has been this era of inevitability, and it's a short period of time. Remember, you know, we are living in dog years now, but it was really, you know, just a little bit more than a week ago after his win in South Carolina, where we saw this extremely orchestrated show of unity from the Democratic Party. It was almost like a mini convention, right, with Amy Klobuchar, with Pete Buttigieg, with Hillary Clinton, with—it really was like, you know, we are united as a party behind this candidate after he had won one primary and lost badly the three previous ones. So since that time, there's not been a debate. There has been very, very controlled media access. And now, on the eve of the moment when Joe Biden, who absolutely had a very good night last night, and as Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez said, there's no sugarcoating this. There are real issues that the Sanders campaign has to address. But it deserves this opportunity to put the very different platforms to voters in the midst of a health crisis, an economic crisis, a deepening and spiraling xenophobia crisis. We need to debate the issues. And everybody who is talking about shutting it down and unity are talking about protecting their candidate from voters. And Donald Trump is not going to shut any puppies down. He is going to go after Joe Biden with the gloves off. And I know it was very popular to say a while back that Bernie Sanders has not been vetted. Look, Joe Biden, before that fateful primary in South Carolina, had been written off by many of the pundits who are now saying that he is inevitable. So it has been months since we have put real scrutiny on this candidate with the full spotlight of a presidential debate, and we absolutely have to do it.
Well, Naomi, I wanted to ask you in terms of—I agree with you completely that the establishment consolidated behind Joe Biden at almost lightning speed, which I think should have been something expected by the progressive movement, because they're clear we're not going to give Bernie Sanders a clear ride to the nomination. But I wanted to ask you about the vote in Michigan specifically. Mm-hmm. From what I can tell, and I'm just doing the rough count on this, there were at least 1.5 million people who voted in Michigan last night. That's about a 50% increase over the votes from 2016. So there is definitely enthusiasm by the electorate to get involved in the political process. The interesting thing to me was that, from what I can tell, Bernie Sanders' vote increased by 7,000 votes. In other words, he basically got the same number of votes this time that he got last time. Now, it could have been—
And he won last time.
And he won last time, but because there was a much lower turnout, that's why Hillary Clinton ended up getting defeated. Now, Michigan was an open primary, mm-hmm. so that means that independents and Republicans could vote as well. So it could have been that there was a shift in people who joined last time to vote against Hillary Clinton, and then this side decided to stay out. But there clearly seems to be an indication that Bernie Sanders has solid support, but is not growing his support from beyond his previous numbers. I'm wondering, with your thinking about what the campaign needs to do to change its strategy in the remaining primaries.
Well, there is no doubt that they have to do much more to reach out to older voters. In particular, older African-American voters, but across the board. I mean, Bernie Sanders' campaign has been a youth-led campaign. It is strong in certain communities in really quite remarkable ways. In the Latino community, we saw it very strongly in Nevada. In Michigan, we also saw extraordinary support in the Muslim community, which is a story that I think is quite a beautiful story, that we have this, you know, first Jewish presidential candidate, you know, who actually has a chance, and he has this amazing base of support in the Muslim community. That's a story that we should be telling. That's a story we should be celebrating. But that isn't the story that we've been reading, you know, in the papers and hearing talked about on television. But there is no doubt that this is a campaign that needs to do more to reach voters who are feeling really scared and are reaching for something familiar, something that feels solid, and are afraid of taking a risk. The message that Sanders is riskier than Biden is a message that has gotten through in the press. Here's the truth, Juan. Both candidates carry risks. And I say this as somebody who strongly supports Bernie Sanders. There's no doubt that there are risks associated with a candidate who has described himself as a democratic socialist for years. It is also true that we know from 2016 that it is risky to have a candidate who is associated with all of the neoliberal baggage of the Democratic Party, a candidate who has lied repeatedly, who is confused repeatedly, who has all these other risks. So let's have a real conversation about risks and make the case to the American public about which candidate offers not just, everyone carries risks, but who offers the most promise, right? And we haven't had that debate yet.
Well, there is supposed to be a debate on Sunday night, supposed to take place in Phoenix, and the Biden and the Sanders campaign were arguing about how it should be carried out, sitting or standing. Sanders also didn't want it to be a town hall format, which the DNC and CNN were pushing for, the idea of people in the audience asking questions as well. He wanted it head to head. But now there will be no audience because of the coronavirus. But I wanted to bring Alicia Garza into this conversation. Again, we're going to be talking with her not only about the primaries, but also about this time in which they are taking place, primaries in a time of coronavirus. But Alicia Garza, last night, when these statements were coming out of Congressmember Clyburn and James Carville and others, you tweeted, "This is very disturbing, especially because that's not how any of this is supposed to work. I couldn't agree more. Keep the debates. Make sure that the issues that Black people care about are being discussed. And also, Biden needs to work for these votes." Now, you have been a supporter of Elizabeth Warren. Naomi is a supporter of Bernie Sanders. Talk about your reaction last night. And I should add, by the way, as we're speaking now, North Dakota has just been called for Bernie Sanders, his first victory of Super Tuesday night. Vice President Biden has won four states, and they're neck and neck in Washington state, though Bernie Sanders, that was a totally mail-in state, and people were encouraged not to lick their stamps, and the people who were opening those envelopes all had to wear gloves because of the coronavirus. But he is neck and neck, but ahead of Biden in Washington state. Alicia.
I could not agree more that last night was a challenging and in some ways disappointing evening. What's real is that when we're talking about the Democratic National Convention, we need to make sure that we are literally ensuring the integrity of the process. And the integrity of the process is not about skipping steps. It's about letting voters hear from candidates about the issues that are important to us. And the reality is, the last few debates that we've had have been full of candidates. And frankly, I think a lot of voters felt like confused about where people stood on issues that mattered to them. And then, of course, there were lots of skirmishes that were happening between candidates as well. One of my favorites, of course, was Elizabeth Warren literally ethering Mayor Michael Bloomberg around his record with women and his record on the economy. But beyond that, I think what's real is that we are seeing, sure, that there are a lot of voters who are turning out to make their preferences heard. And I think we have to be a lot clearer about the message that Black voters are sending. Some of this is about trust. Some of this is about fear. Some of this is about beating Donald Trump. But I think that this is also about a level of familiarity. And in that level of familiarity, I think one of the things that that black voters, and of course we're not a monolith, but one of the things that black communities stand to lose by following such a recommendation as the one that Representative Clyburn made last night is that we don't actually get to litigate the candidates who are left on the issues that are important to us. I don't know about you, but I'm not totally clear. What is Joe Biden's policy platform? And how does that relate to improving the lives of black communities across this country, including the one that I live in? That is what these debates are for, and that is what this party is for, quite frankly. It's not to skip steps, rush process. It is to make sure that voters not only feel informed about what these candidates are saying they're going to do to represent us, but it's also an opportunity to push candidates on issues that they haven't spoken about. And thirdly, it's an opportunity to shape the issues that come out of the party itself. We all know that what happens at the DNC in July is not just choosing a nominee, it's actually choosing the platform and the program for the party as a whole over the next 4 years. And so I would say we deserve much better than a rushed process that presumes somebody to be the nominee that, frankly, I think a lot of voters are still questioning, what are your policy positions? What is your platform? And what are the things that you are going to do to represent us, knowing that we're not going back to an Obama White House, that we are going into a hopefully a post-Trump White House, which is a very different political landscape. And I think black voters in particular, especially as we've turned out and shaped contests across this country, we really do deserve to hear more about what you're going to do to advance the issues that I think all of us care about, the issues of health care, the issues of community safety and security, the issues of climate change and what's happening in our environment all around us, the issues of low wages that are keeping families from being able to support themselves. And, of course, you're right that we now are moving into a period where we are also fighting a global pandemic. And we're doing so under an administration that has proven itself to be incredibly incompetent in terms of not only mitigating the challenges, but also projecting a forward vision. And so as a result, there are more than 1,000 cases of people across this country who have fallen ill. And we still don't have enough tests, don't have enough medical equipment, and frankly, don't have enough protections for the workers who are taking care of people who are sick. So there's a lot at stake in this next season, and I would hope that we didn't follow that model.
I wanted to ask you about the situation, the vote last night in Washington. Some of the NBC exit polls from NBC indicate that not only was there a sharp gender divide in the vote, with Biden getting substantially more votes from women than men, but that also the late breaking voters, many of the Elizabeth Warren middle class white women, broke for Biden at the end. I'm wondering your sense, since you were a backer of Elizabeth Warren, whether it, from your perspective, it was the right call for her to not make an endorsement, to sit out this portion of the Democratic primaries, and your sense of how that affected her supporters.
I want to be really clear. I think the progressive movement missed a big opportunity to unite behind both Warren and Sanders in a front that would have pushed a progressive nominee into the convention. And so we always knew that, at least from my perspective, that Elizabeth Warren was a coalition candidate and was able to actually bring together many different segments of the Democratic Party, which is necessary to win. What is also necessary to win is the movement that Bernie Sanders and his campaign have built with newer voters and younger voters and more diverse voters. And those factions actually needed to come together to unite against a status quo candidate, and we have not taken advantage of that opportunity. With that being said, I think now voters are choosing where they want to go, and they're choosing between Bernie Sanders and Joe Biden. Some of Elizabeth Warren's supporters have broken towards Bernie Sanders, and others have broken towards Joe Biden. I think the bigger conversation is, what will the progressive movement do moving forward? board. It's fully voters' prerogative to decide who they think is the best candidate, and that actually has more to do with the organizing of those campaigns, I think, than it does anything else. And so, again, when we see women breaking for a particular candidate, when we see African Americans breaking for a particular candidate, this is something for us to be paying attention to, mostly in terms of thinking through how is our message, right, not only reaching these various constituencies, and the Sanders campaign has done, I think, an excellent job of trying to reach folks who have been feeling disaffected and disengaged and left behind. And I think what this primary process has shown us is that there are many different factions that have to be united in order to secure victory. And I think our progressive movement has some real reflection to do about which factions got left behind that I think are now breaking for Joe Biden.
Naomi Klein.
Well, I absolutely agree with Alicia that there was a coalition that could have won, a progressive coalition, and that could still win, but obviously the chances are much slimmer. And so it is painful to be that close and realize that we didn't do it. And I mean, I will say, as somebody for whom, you know, Elizabeth Warren was my second choice, I would have, if she had won, I would have gladly worked my butt off, you know, for her. It is, to me, a tremendous lost opportunity and a bit of a heartbreak that she did not come forward in the face of that kind of ruthless show of unity that we saw from the Democratic candidates who are more associated with the corporate wing of the party backing Joe Biden. We needed that from the candidates who were running on Medicare for All, that who were running on a Green New Deal, who were running, you know, against the criminalization of migration. We needed them to stand with us, and we still do. We still do. And I want to be very clear. I am not saying that Elizabeth Warren owes this to Bernie Sanders. I agree with all the people saying she doesn't owe anything to Bernie Sanders. I do believe that as an elected politician who ran on a platform of Medicare for All, of a Green New Deal, of standing up for migrant rights and standing up against racism and standing up for women's rights, that she owes it to those issues because she has spent her political career attacking so much of what Joe Biden stands for. And if her critique of Bernie Sanders is that he doesn't get things done as well as she does, I would have loved for her to say, okay, now I'm going to help you get things done. And I know that our movement would have welcomed her with open arms. So, I really reject the idea that it is some kind of anti-feminist issue to say to Elizabeth Warren, we need you to stand with us, because it is not about Bernie. People in this movement are not fighting for Bernie Sanders. They're fighting for Medicare for All. They're fighting for a Green New Deal. They are fighting for the issues that they need to survive.
We have to break. We're going to come back to this discussion and so much more, especially as we conduct this broadcast in the midst of this time of the coronavirus pandemic. And we are also going to be joined by the president of National Nurses United. Naomi Klein is with us, senior correspondent at The Intercept. She is professor of media, culture, and feminist studies at Rutgers University, where Juan is also a professor. And Juan, is the university yet online and with school itself closed?
No, it's the classes will stop tomorrow, and then after spring break, we'll be going online. Plus, all of the students have been urged to leave the dormitories as well. So there's basically going to be a shutdown of the campus.
And fascinatingly, here in New York, it looks like most of the private colleges have gone online, have closed, like Columbia and Barnard and NYU. CUNY, there's just massive petitions online saying, why haven't you also let us go online? We'll see what happens today. Alicia Garza also is our guest with the National Domestic Workers Alliance, particularly significant now during the coronavirus with Black Futures Lab and the Black Lives Matter Global Network. We'll be back in a minute. instrumental, Binance. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez.
We continue now to look at the 2020 presidential race that is unfolding in the middle of the coronavirus pandemic. Tuesday night, former Vice President Joe Biden scored decisive primary victories in four states, including the key state of Michigan. His rival, Senator Bernie Sanders, won in North Dakota, and votes are still being counted in Washington state. Biden is still less than halfway to the delegate count he would need to secure the Democratic nomination.
While campaigning in Michigan ahead of the primary, Senator Sanders touted his trade policy credentials, attacked Biden for supporting international trade deals like NAFTA, the North American Free Trade Agreement.
Today, I think, as we're down to a two-person race, that the people of Michigan understand that there are very substantive differences between Joe Biden and myself.
That's right. That's right.
Here in Michigan, where trade agreements have been so devastating in the loss of over 100,000 good-paying jobs, Joe Biden voted for NAFTA. He voted for PNTR with China. I helped lead the opposition
to those disasters. That's right.
Yeah!
In terms of foreign policy judgment, Joe Biden voted for the war in Iraq, the worst foreign policy blunder in the modern history of this country.
Yes. Yeah.
We led the opposition against.
That's right.
And in terms of looking to the future, I happen to believe, and I believe for years, that health care is a human right for all.
That's right. Yes.
Not just a privilege.
For more, we continue with The Intercept's Naomi Klein, a professor at Rutgers University, and Alicia Garza, strategy and partnerships director for the National Domestic Workers Alliance, co-founder of Black Lives Matter Global Network. Naomi, let's begin with you on this issue of trade and take it beyond that. I mean, right now we're in a time when the Dow has tanked with this oil war is taking place between Saudi Arabia and Russia. People are talking about disaster capitalism.
Yeah, well, this is we are seeing that. We are seeing this very predictable process that we see in the midst of every economic crisis, which is extreme corporate opportunism of sort of dusting off whatever the wish list is, whether it's privatizing Social Security, whether it's handouts for the more handouts for the fossil fuel industry. And so in the face of this economic crisis, market crisis, the crash in the price of oil, and of course the health crisis, the Trump administration is not solving the crisis. What they're doing is what they always do, which is talking to lobbyists and asking them, what do you want? And so we're seeing bailouts for the airline industry, bailouts for the cruise industry, bailouts for the hotel industry, Trump's own industry, it must be said. So this underlines this issue that we have had throughout this administration, which is that we have a sitting president who has not divested from his corporate empire, and as he has continued to profit from it from the presidency, but now we are seeing a bailout for his own sector. He is in an absolutely direct conflict of interest. Now we're seeing with the Saudi orchestrated a very dramatic drop in the price of oil. This basically makes domestic oil, the overwhelming majority of domestic oil production, gas production in North America, uneconomic because so much of it is deep water drilling, tight oil, fracking, tar sands oil in Canada. All of this is predicated on higher prices. And so this sector was already in crisis. The fracking industry was already dealing with a debt crisis because the price of oil was already too low. Now that it's at around $30 a barrel, it's completely uneconomic. And so now we're hearing talk of directly bailing out the fossil fuel sector. What I think is worth noting about all of this is that these are the companies at the heart of the climate crisis, right? And so, you know, one of the things that's happening, and this is why we so desperately need the debate to tie it in with what we were talking about earlier, is, you know, while it is true that a bunch of losing candidates in the Democratic primary have endorsed Joe Biden, reality keeps endorsing Bernie Sanders. That is true for Medicare for All, and we're going to be hearing from NNU and Alicia Garza more on that. Because it is the care sector. It is nurses and home care workers who are on the front lines of this crisis. And we are seeing the living argument for why we need everybody to have health insurance, everybody to have paid sick leave. But instead of that, we have the Trump administration talking about cutting the payroll tax, which, of course, is a backdoor way of cutting Social Security and then privatizing Social Security. So it is extremely relevant that Joe Biden has a decades-long track record of trying to cut Social Security in a bipartisan way. But more importantly, Juan, the Green New Deal is an economic stimulus. If we need an economic stimulus, let's have an economic stimulus. But instead of bailing out the companies at the heart of the climate crisis, why wouldn't we stimulate the parts of our economy that will bring us to real safety, right? This is why we need to talk about what is real risk here. And so this is the moment to talk about all of these core issues at the heart of the progressive platform, whether it was Sanders or Warren, Medicare for all, Green New Deal, attacking economic precarity, all of it, rights of workers, the right to unionize, which is also a big part of why workers are going to work sick, spreading the virus, and so on.
And Naomi, you mentioned the proposed payroll tax cut, but that would be a way of selling this to the American public in general as a temporary tax cut, which obviously drives up even more the trillion-dollar deficit. But at the same time, then, providing these bailouts that will last long beyond the temporary tax cut.
Well, exactly. Look, if we're worried about people's ability to pay their bills, there are much more direct ways to offer relief. I mean, in Italy, they have just suspended mortgage payments, for instance, in the midst of the virus outbreak. So there are more direct ways of helping people than this very clear backdoor way of going after Social Security. Because if you deplete the financing of the program, then a few months from now or a year from now, that becomes the excuse. Sorry, we created a crisis. We have no choice. We have to cut it. And that's why we need to be looking very carefully at the candidates right now.
The Intercept's and Rutgers University professor Naomi Klein. When we come back, again, we will be joined by Alicia Garza and we'll be joined by the president of the National Nurses United, Gene Ross. Stay with us. No, it isn't. Angel by Massive Attack. This is Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez.
We turn now to look at how healthcare workers are being put at risk as the coronavirus pandemic continues to spread. The number of cases in the U.S. passed 1,000 Tuesday, with the rate of infections likely increasing. 32 people in the country have died. Despite this, the U.S. continues to lag on testing, and healthcare workers say they lack adequate protection and protocols to allow them to safely care for infected patients. They also say the country's hospitals are woefully unprepared to handle the crisis. Nurses in the hot zones of California and Washington had already reported having to beg for face masks and decried a systemic lack of guidance on how to address the virus. But Tuesday, National Nurses United said the Centers for Disease Control actually weakened its guidelines on responding to the pandemic.
In response, nurses with the National Nurses United and California Nurses Association National Nurses Organizing Committee are holding a national day of action today to demand better protections for healthcare workers and the public. This all comes as coronavirus has also rallied nurses around the fight for Medicare for all. On Tuesday, Vice President Mike Pence spoke about health insurance for people who contract coronavirus.
Today, President Trump assembled the top health insurance executives in America. And as we announced earlier today, all of our major health insurance companies have now joined with Medicare and Medicaid and agreed to waive all co-pays, cover the cost of all treatment for those who contract the coronavirus. They've committed to no surprise billing, and they've committed to encourage telemedicine.
Bonnie Castillo, Executive Director of National Nurses United, tweeted earlier this week, COVID-19 lays bare truths nurses know all too well. Our healthcare system is cruel, inhumane, and inefficient. It's our duty to protect public health. We must rise to the challenge. Any vaccine or treatment developed with taxpayer dollars must be provided free of charge. Well, for more, we go to Minneapolis, where we're joined by National Nurses United President Gene Ross. Still with us, The Intercept's Naomi Klein and Alicia Garza, who's with National Domestic Workers Alliance. Gene Ross, thank you for joining us. Talk about today's day of action, what you're calling for, and where Medicare for All fits into this story in this time of coronavirus.
Well, basically, we're calling for protections for registered nurses and other healthcare workers who are the people that are going to be caring for the COVID-19 affected patients. Right now, we did a survey at the end of February. And what we found was only 29% of our nurses and other nurses that were surveyed said that there was a plan in place to deal with any of these patients. 23% said they didn't even know if there was a plan. We had only 63% that said they had enough N95 respirators. 23% said they had what we call PAPRs, powered air purifying respirators. Only 30% said they could come up with enough what we call PPE, personal protective equipment, should there be a surge in COVID-19 patients. And some said they just plain didn't know. And we have been calling for this protection for healthcare workers, not just for many months now, but also, if you recall, since the Ebola crisis hit our shores. And sad to say, we are still very lacking.
Could you talk about the most vulnerable communities, including undocumented immigrants and those with no health insurance whatsoever? What prevents them then to go to a hospital to seek care even if they get sick?
Well, if we had a national health care system like some other countries do, we would be in a far better position. For example, if you look at a country like Canada, who had to undergo the SARS crisis, and they were able to do it in large part because of that system. We have such a patchwork here that's dependent on profit. Then our homeless communities, our immigrants that you mentioned, those of lower economic status are going to be the ones hardest hit. They're going to not want to come in because they don't have the money to pay. They may or may not have heard about what the vice president just said. But that still is insurance companies, for-profit companies, deciding what they'll do, and not our government, our society, deciding what we'll do for people who need care.
Exit polls in every state voting Super Tuesday, too, showed strong support for Medicare for All, including in Mississippi, where it has the backing of nearly two-thirds of Democratic voters. But speaking on MSNBC Monday, Joe Biden indicated if elected president, he would veto Medicare for All legislation should Congress send it to his desk. This is what he said.
Your president, Bernie Sanders, is still active in the Senate. He manages to get Medicare for All through the Senate in some compromised version, the Elizabeth Warren version or other version. Nancy Pelosi gets a version of it through the House of Representatives. It comes to your desk. Do you veto it?
I would veto anything that delays providing the security and the certainty of health care being available now. If they got that through and by some miracle, and there was an epiphany that occurred, and some miracle occurred that said, okay, it's passed, then you got to look at the cost. I want to know, how did they find the $35 trillion? What is that doing? Is it going to significantly raise taxes on the middle class? Which it will. What's going to happen? Look, my opposition isn't to the principle that you should have Medicare. I mean, health care should be a right in America. My opposition relates to whether or not, A, it's doable, two, what the cost is, and what the consequences for the rest of the budget are.
That's Joe Biden, Gene Ross, president of National Nurses United. Let's get your response, and Alicia Garza and Naomi Klein.
Well, first of all, it's not that health care should be a human right. It just plain is. And we see now that the American people agree with us. As far as cost, I believe he knows exactly what it's costing now, and we can't afford what we are doing. So any cost that would be incurred with putting it in place would be far outweighed by the savings that we would have afterward. I'm afraid that until we keep insisting that those for-profit insurance companies are part of a system, we will never achieve what we need to guarantee care for everyone as a human right.
Let's go to Alicia Garza, who, among the hats she wears, is with the National Domestic Workers Alliance. Alicia.
I mean, if nothing else, we can see here that Joe Biden is not Obama. And frankly, I would agree that what's at stake here are millions of workers, many of whom are immigrant workers and workers of color and women and people who are trying to put food on their tables while also caring for other people and doing so in the midst, as I said earlier, of a global pandemic. I work with domestic workers who are people who work inside of people's homes. For us, a home is a workplace. And frankly, domestic workers are locked out of most federal labor protections that should protect all workers, that would give workers sick days and paid time off. And we're seeing that in the midst of this pandemic, the real kind of underpinnings of the abuses that workers are facing in this economy are coming to broad daylight. Domestic workers already don't have access to paid time off, paid sick days, et cetera, and are caring for some of the most vulnerable people in our society and helping to make families make ends meet. And so one of the things that we're really concerned about is making sure that, at the very least, that there is an expansion of access to the things that people need, particularly in this type of crisis, but in general and overall. People need access to affordable and quality health care. And in this very moment, people also need to be able to take time off, take care of their families, and take sick days, or else this global pandemic will continue to spread. And under this current administration, I don't think there's any reason for us to think that they've got it under control. In fact, that could have happened months ago. And now we are in a situation where, as we understand it, containment is not possible. So what we can do in this moment is make sure, particularly, that the people who are caring for folk who have been affected by this crisis, including nurses, including domestic workers, are well taken care of in this moment. And a way to do that is to make sure that protections are strong. And another way to do that is to make sure that we're holding this administration accountable for keeping insurance companies in check.
Alicia, if I can just cut you off a second, because we just have about 30 seconds. We want to get Naomi to get her final words in on this.
Well, look, I agree completely. This administration is uniquely ill-equipped to deal with this crisis because they are not treating it as a health crisis. They're treating it as a PR crisis. They've shown again and again that they, when they don't like reality, they just try to bury it. I mean, in the same way that they don't want to talk about, what our satellites are measuring in terms of climate change, in the same way that they suppress the number of people who died after Hurricane Maria in Puerto Rico. Now they think that by not testing, this crisis is going to go away. And we need leadership that actually is guided by objective reality and science and puts people first.
We're going to have to leave it there, but of course we continue with you tomorrow. We're going to focus on the issue of paid sick leave and so much more, bringing you updates from New Rochelle, the epicenter in the country, and other places around the world. Naomi Klein, senior correspondent at The Intercept, inaugural Gloria Steinem Chair of Media, Culture, and Feminist Studies at Rutgers University. Alicia Garza with the National Domestic Workers Alliance, Black Futures Lab, Black Lives Matter Global Network, and Gene Ross, president of National Nurses United, speaking to us from Minneapolis. That does it for our show. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez. Thanks so much for joining us, and be safe.